Dan Blewett here. Let's talk about curveball grips and the physics of the curveball. So number one, the basic curveball grip, if you make an L between your ring finger and your middle finger, and you jam the ball in this way so that you have it facing up the horseshoe here. So the horseshoe is like that. My finger is curling right down along it. That's the base of this pitch, and then the bottom two fingers are going to be right here. The thumb is going to be on the inside of this seam right here. So now I'm catching the tacky, grippy seam here on the descending edge, and I'm also catching it with my thumb kind of on the way up, because we're going to spin it a little bit like that. So from this view, we have this. All right, so these two are doing their job to tilt the ball that direction. So when you have this curveball grip, then the next step is, what do we do with our index finger? Because the index finger can just screw the pitch up if it's pushing pressure into the center of the ball, which we don't want. All the pressure should be on the descending edge to create spin that way, because we're trying to spin the ball as tightly and as fastly as we can. So this finger has a couple options. It can stick straight up, a la Adam Wainwright. You can cross it over. It can just sort of hang out on the ball and not put pressure. That's what I do. You can put your knuckle down. Obviously, this is a knuckle curve. Or you can put your fingernail into the ball like that. There is no difference between a knuckle curve and a regular curveball. It's executed the same exact way because these two fingers are the reason that we can align the spin to get a clean spin axis towards home plate. The knuckle action, I've had some players tell me that, oh, I push with it and that's how I get more spin, that's how my curveball is sharper. That doesn't make any sense because I'm spinning the ball this way. How could this knuckle push that way and produce spin this way? Right? It just doesn't make any sense. There's a lot of times when athletes think they're doing one thing and they're actually doing something very different. So the curveball grip, what this index finger does, could make it a curveball or a knuckle curve or a pointer curveball, whatever you want to call it, it doesn't really make a difference. This is just a placeholder for the index finger because it really doesn't have much of a job except for stay out of the way. So our goal with the curveball is to get no mixture of spin. If we drilled a hole through this ball and we could spin on only on that, so you put a screwdriver through it, the ball would only spin on one axis in the direction that it's traveling. So if it's going straight towards the plate and spinning purely from 12 to 6, it'll have a 12 to 6 break. If it's 1 to 7, and we want a 1 to 7 curveball, or if I'm a lefty, 11 to 5, it needs to have a very clean, again, we drill a hole right through the ball and it spins only on one axis. It doesn't have like a mixture of spins where it's starting to like, it doesn't actually wobble, but it has a sloppy mixture of spin. So young pitchers, when they come in, they throw this little league curveball and they get on the side of it, or they get a little bit at the top, but a lot on the side, and then they have this mixture of spins and not a very good spin efficiency is what they call it. The Rapso company calls it spin efficiency. How efficiently does it spin on just one axis? And is that axis aligned with home plate, with the direction that it's traveling? So if I'm out like this and I get a great spin axis like this, it's not gonna produce quality break. And the reason is this: we're trying to capitalize on the Magnus effect. That's the physics, the property of physics that produces lift or break. So with the Magnus effect, when the ball is spinning in the direction it's traveling, it creates a high pressure zone of air above it and lower pressure on the bottom of it. So what that does is the higher pressure air pushes the ball down. So it makes it deviate off the normal path if you threw it with no spin much faster. So the faster the spin that we can create, the harder we throw it, the more suddenly it'll appear to break to a hitter. And that's pretty much all you need to know. So your goal is align the spin towards home plate, whether it's 12 to 6 or 1 to 7, and then get the ball to spin as fast as we possibly can, because that's going to create more of that high pressure, low pressure that causes the break. And then the faster we throw it, the more it will appear to be a fastball longer. And when it finally deviates and starts to break, because it actually breaks gradually the whole time, it doesn't actually have a sharp break, it will deceive the hitter more and it will appear very, very sudden. All right. So that's an overview of what the curveball does. And that's pretty much all you need to know. But our task, when we're learning this pitch or when we're trying to improve it, even for a big leaguer, so if a big leaguer has a very average curveball compared to a guy who has a fantastic curveball, the average curveball is just not gonna have as good of a spin axis, not as good spin efficiency, and it's not gonna have as fast as many RPMs of spin, and he's not gonna throw it as hard. So the harder you throw it, the more RPMs you put on it, and the better the axis, again, better spin efficiency, the better your curveball will be. That's why these new companies that measure this are having success, because they can say, okay, we have 96% spin efficiency at 2,700 RPMs at 79 miles per hour. Like, we know that's a very great swing and miss curveball. You know, 76% spin efficiency with 2,200 RPMs and 72 miles per hour. We know that's objectively not gonna get as many swings and misses as the previous one. So again, our goal is when we throw this pitch is to get our fingers to the front of it where we can, as we come through, align the spin towards the plate. So we get 12-6 or 1-7, as many RPMs as possible, throwing it as hard as we can possibly throw it with as clean of a spin axis as we can produce.